Either I'm sliding through in that fucking coupe, or I'm rolling dope on my fucking stupid. Either way's okay, we can get it any day. See, I like the button, then I lose the roof. My drugs kill them like homicide. Eyes replaced with them dollar signs. They get on board, let alone the grind. I've been searching all night, and I've yet to find another one like I. Team like mine, we feed the drugs and we watch them die. I never talk, I never walk. I'm posted smoking, should I let it spark? I'm standing hoping that you try to bark. I got dogs in the yard, bitch, make the call. Let them off the chain, they come down like rain and watch you and your whole damn team away. Thunder and lightning and storming outside. See that it's both, so you cannot just hide. See that it's sex, so you cannot deny. If you don't abide, get ready to die. Thunder and lightning and storming outside. See that it's both, so you cannot just hide. See that it's sex, so you cannot deny. If you don't abide, get ready to die. Ready to die, ready to die. If you don't abide, get ready to die.
Thank you. fight today. To open the can of pain. Some scorch and blistering. Do you know that it's all gone?
Tired of running to the pharmacy for your pet's prescriptions?
What's going on, guys? Make sure everything is good to go here. Get RetroArch fired up. Yeah, Keith. It took a lot for me to be convinced to switch to PC, dude. I was always a console gamer, dude. Money was always the big thing for me, like spending that kind of money up front on a PC. I think right now I have a little over $1,500 in the mine, but it probably would have been cheaper than that if the graphics card that they installed when I first got my PC didn't take a shit. So yeah, I had to spend $400 to replace the graphics card, but I won't have to do any upgrades or anything like that for years, dude. Especially the games that I'm playing. I don't really play a whole lot of AAA titles anymore. That kind of died out for me on console. I don't look for the next big game, and if I do, it's usually going to be anywhere from $20 to $30 on Steam and not some $60 game that you might not even enjoy, dude. There's just so many games, dude, that I've gotten on PC that I paid literally next to nothing for. I think I got the whole Batman collection on PC, like three or four games for $8, dude. So the sales are a lot more frequent, and the discounts are a lot better. You don't have to pay for online. You're already paying for internet. That's enough in my eyes, you know. I'm paying no $100 a year now. I think it's like $90 to $100 a year for PlayStation Plus now. And I mean, okay, they give you older games, but all of those older games could be easily obtained on a PC for literally nothing, dude. So yeah, it's just something to consider when you plan on going into the PC realm. It's a bit costly in the beginning, you know, to buy the PC that you want. I lucked out and got mine. It was, maybe it's going on 5 years, because I got mine right before COVID hit. And there was a shortage on chips, which made all the, most of the PC parts go up in price. So yeah, I, long-term PC was the way to go for me. I think what did it was, I kept spending $60 a game on PlayStation. Some of them were games that I would beat in 8 to 9 hours, and that's pretty much the end of it. You know, that's your $60. And not that there aren't games on PlayStation that you can put $60 into and get hundreds of hours out of, but there were a lot of games that I was watching people play at the time that I couldn't play because they were all PC. And I just kind of, as a gamer, wanted to open that library up just a little bit more, because there were just a lot of repeat titles on PlayStation, or like cookie cutter shit that I felt like it's nothing new that I haven't played before. And you know, you could say the same thing about some PC games, but there's a lot of developers on PC that they have all these new interesting titles or ideas that I just was no longer seeing on PlayStation, because I was on PlayStation since fucking PS1, dude. I loved Sony, but it's just, if you're a gamer, dude, and I'm not the PC master race guy, you know, that's like, you know, PC's the best thing ever. I just think, as a gamer, if you're really big into gaming, you should definitely do yourself a favor. And even if you can't afford a PC, dude, and you kind of wanted to go the PC route, I think the Steam Deck is a great option. I think I paid $400 for my Steam Deck, and You can put upgraded hard drive in it for, or not a hard drive, but a solid state drive for $70-$80, and you have like basically a $500 machine that you can take with you because it's handheld, but it can also be docked like the Switch. But it can play a good chunk of PC games, even ones that it says are unsupported. I still get pretty decent luck playing games that are unsupported for the Steam Deck to run on the Steam Deck. There's some workarounds and stuff, but that's my thoughts is, if you're a person that wants to get into PC gaming and you don't want to spend, you know, in the upwards of, I don't know, $800-$900 to all the way up to $1,100 somewhere for a PC, the Steam Deck will definitely fill that void. And again, you buy a Steam Deck, you're not paying for yearly online services, or if you pay monthly. A lot of my friends that are still playing on console, that is kind of where I've led them, is check out Steam Deck if you want to get into PC gaming and you don't want to spend that kind of money. Steam Deck looks good on a TV, especially if you set everything, you know, settings wise is right, and you still have access to a good portion of games on PC. I was able to run Black Ops 3 on mine for zombies. I was able to run Infinite Warfare on mine for zombies. It's just a really good handheld system that can be docked, and it runs most PC games. It's some of the games that I've played on my Steam Deck, it's unbelievable that they run on it, but they do. So that's my suggestion if you're trying to go that route. I look at it like a PS5 is $500. That's not including any games. That's not including your online service. So for $500, you could buy a Steam Deck and an SSD drive. Swap out the SSD drive. It's like literally like 8 screws on the back. And Steam also like pretty much encourages you to take this thing apart. And there's no voiding that warranty. They will RMA it as long as you didn't purposely do anything to destroy the machine. I just think, dude, for the price of a PS5, you have all these PC games at your, like, you know, disposal, and you're not going to spend all that money doing the yearly or monthly subscription. It just makes so much more sense to me. And the games that you can play are similar to the shit that I play on my PC. But Clock Tower. Back to Clock Tower today. I did find out some things on Clock Tower. I did find out that the Nolan ending that I got, where he just ran out of the house after I put the powdered soap in the dog's face and it just ended, was because I missed a statue that is in the closet that I hid in from Scissor Man, but I didn't check the closet twice. If you check the closet once, it says it looks like there's something in there. You check it again, and your dude will pull the statue out of the closet. You leave with the statue and you're good to go. The reason why I got the ending that I got is because Nolan left the house without the statue, so any information on the Scissor Man or the Clock Tower murders was pretty much lost. So yeah, we're going to get back into Clock Tower. I really think that... I'm going to start back where I was in the Jennifer scenario. And go through that house with Nolan again, I think is the best way to go about this. So I will switch this all over for you guys so that everybody can see and hear everything. Yeah, I don't know, man. I've had nothing but good times on PC so far. I don't do a lot of online gaming anymore. I don't really play a lot of games like Call of Duty or, you know, anything like that multiplayer-wise. My PC could definitely support it. I just don't really get into a lot of those AAA titles or games that... everybody's getting hype for. I feel like most of those games end up being a major letdown. Yes, definitely one of the top booting sounds of all time. I would say Dreamcast is up there for me as well. I loved the Dreamcast boot screen. Thanks for hopping in, Josh. We continue the Scissor Madness today. I guess I should watch how I word that. But yeah, you're going to have access to anything like this, dude. And I don't know. I would. I'll say this. I would go as far as to, if anybody buys a PC to game on and they ever had any issues, you could personally hit me up. Yes, we're going to scissor everyone today. But yeah, you could definitely hit me up. I would walk you through whatever, man. I think it's like that dope of an experience that... everybody, I feel like, even if you're not, I think the most overwhelming thing for a lot of people is, I don't really want to switch to mouse and keyboard. And it's like, well, there are most of the games that run on PC, you can opt to use a controller. And if you can't opt to use a controller, once you get used to mouse and keyboard, for some games, it is better than controller. Older FPSs, I won't say new ones, obviously, because most new first-person shooters have aim assist, and so if you have a controller, you actually have an advantage over people with mouse and keyboard. But yeah, we're going to go back to Jennifer's scenario here, because I realized that I forgot that statue in the closet, so... Muppet nose again. Look at that lady's nose, bro. They're like, here, just make her nose shapes. Yeah, I don't know. I think your options are just a lot more open with PC, especially if you are a gamer. Yeah, that nose is half her face, bro. You're not lying. So this is what I didn't understand here. They're having this conversation right now. Never once do they ask this dude, Professor Barton, where the fucking statue is. And if they would have asked about the statue, a huge portion of this would have been avoided. But we're not here to make sense, people. All right, so I'm going to go to the hotel because Edward is there. And I pretty much got to go right back through all of this shit again. But when we get to the house with Nolan, I know where the statue is. There's a couple other things that I missed too. Like, I don't know who all was watching, but if you watch the part two stream of Clock Tower, I noticed in the house with Nolan, there was like a, it looked like a baseball bat down in the basement or down in one of the rooms. It was the laundry room actually. And where you get the soap to blind the dog. If you are being chased by Scissorman and you run into that room, you will be able to click on that mop head. Or the mop handle, I should say. And Nolan will close the door and put the mop handle underneath the doorknob so that Scissorman cannot get to you. We're going to go see Nolan here. Oh, Nolan is. He's worried about you. Yeah, I don't know, man. I think back to the console PC thing, I think that most of the reason why we as gamers gamed on console for so long is, you know, you're used to just throwing a game in and going, you know, being able to play. It's like plug and play, but, you know, in the invention of modern consoles, yes. Yeah, dude. The sounds in this game are fucking absolutely trash. The music is cool. But, yeah, I think that most people are used to the plug and play ability of a console, but now with more modern consoles comes things like updates and, you know, most people think of PC gaming back when we were kids where, you know, you had to type in all this code to get a game to run and, you know, it was just a headache. It is not that. I think I built that up in my head that I didn't really want to switch to PC because I was so used to just putting a disc in and going or putting a cartridge in and going. And it's not, you're not have to enter any code to get games to run. There is no games that I own that I have not been able to get running on my PC having to do a whole bunch of you know, like tinkering around to get shit to run. It's not like that. If you get a game from Steam, you pretty much hit play and that bitch runs. It's really as simple as that. Steam Deck is a little bit more tinkering, especially if you want to play certain games, like if you wanted to play Grand Theft Auto 5 or Red Dead Redemption 2 on Steam Deck. It's not built to outright just run that, but that's not saying that you can't get it to run. So there's a little bit more tinkering around with the Steam Deck, but for the most part, the games just run. I got that Pal World game the other day, and you know, it's not something that I don't know if I would be willing to like just sit here at my PC and game out on Pal World for, you know, like long game sessions. But I definitely would play that bitch on my Steam Deck where I could just kick back and really just get into the game. See, they're asking each other about the statue here, but they could have just asked about it to Professor Barton, and he would have told them, yeah, I had... Yeah, no shit, dude. You're not lying. Look at her nose. It's just like a fucking big-ass triangle. She got that Bert and Ernie nose. All right, so... No reason to go to the library. I'm going to try back here. But yeah, man, I don't know. I've had so much fun gaming on PC. And like I said, I don't even really play multiplayer games anymore. I've kind of more or less gotten away from multiplayer games and just really kind of focus on single player shit now. Or if I do play a multiplayer game, it doesn't have to be something that's as involved or I'm kind of back to, you know, gaming back in the day where you just sat in front of your TV by yourself, or, you know, with somebody else watching you game. And I don't know, online gaming has kind of really died out for me. I was really, really big into online gaming when I first started getting into like Call of Duty and stuff like that, but I'd rather play a game with a really good story or something, you know, over just getting on and shooting and dying and respawning over and over and over again. It just feels monotonous. And I'm not dogging Call of Duty because I definitely spent a lot of time playing the game, but it got to the point where I can only play like two or three matches back to back and I'm just done. All right, so we are going to ask Nolan. But yeah, and with having this channel now, it makes even more sense. I'm playing solo games most of the time anyways. There's a lot of games that I beat years ago or I haven't ever beat, and it just made more sense to get back into solo gaming, and with that came streaming. Yeah, dude, you're not lying, Josh. I don't know, man. I just... I really love the concept of, like, online... like, multiplayer survival game. Like playing with your friends on Ark is an experience that I cannot even describe. I had two PS4s. I had a Pro and a regular one. I got my Pro for Christmas one year. So with me getting the Pro, I ended up using my regular PS4 to act as a dedicated server. And I ran a dedicated server with just me and like five or six buddies. And I let some people in, that would, you know, just public people, but, randoms, I guess you could say. But I ran this server for 5 months and, it really is legit some of the best time gaming that I've had in a long time. I think that's why we remain gamers. We remember, you know, like growing up, I used to play a lot of Sega and Dreamcast and PS1 with my dad and my brother and shit. And, you know, it was like this awesome ass fun way to bring your family closer, you know? And I think that we get older and we look for that in other games, but it's just not there anymore because it's not the same environment, the same experience. And that's not to say that gaming is shit or anything. No, you're not wrong there, Josh. That's my whole thing with gaming is like once other people started really just once everybody could get online and game, it just became fucking atrocious, dude. You know, that's another thing that I liked about PS4 was being able to party chat with your friends, you know, being in a voice chat with your friends and just sitting there and enjoying the game and bullshitting with your buddies. But I found myself enjoying the conversations usually more than the actual game. So, I mean, that's kind of what Discord is for me is, you know. Discord allows me to basically just get into a server, bullshit with my buddies, and gaming doesn't even have to be involved, you know? Obviously, it could be, but so Rick's dead, and the Scissor Man is going to be after me, but I'm going to go. I'm going to go here. Yeah, man, I really think that's, you know, like watching my retro life and stuff like that has really put it into perspective to me. The importance of gaming as a kid and, you know, there were times where my dad, my brother, and I would just be all, oh boy, I'm gonna die. What is he doing? Punched him. Okay, so you guys saw me click on that. Maybe it was because it was too long of time in between or something, but yeah, I don't know, dude. Gaming has definitely changed, and I find myself enjoying games that either remind me of my childhood or modern games that have an old school vibe to them, or survival games, because that's really what I'm big into. Oh my, how? Bro, you saw that, right? You just jumped up out of there. I was gonna hide in that bitch. Let's go back in here. Yeah, no, it is all about dick waving, dude. I don't care about your fucking kill to death ratio, bro. It means nothing to me. Thank you. So here's that I was talking about, where you can prop this mop handle up against the door and he won't be able to get in here. But yeah, that's kind of why I wanted to do this channel. I talked to my dad kind of extensively yesterday about plans for the channel and things like that. And I just really wanted to build a community or get people together that love nostalgic things and retro things. And no matter if it's gaming or movies that you grew up watching or, you know, just those type of things. All right, so I am going to go ahead and take this soap. Yeah, man, I think that's kind of what gaming is all about, dude. If you know, like, even if you're just sitting there with your girlfriend, your boyfriend, your husband, or your wife, and you guys are just playing Mario Kart together, you know, like, that to me is more of an experience than, you know, most other, you're just, even though it's a video game, you still are making memories together. I think that's what gaming, to me, is all about anyways. All right, so. I'm just going to check these things because I don't want it to be something that later on turns out that it stopped me from doing something else within the game. All right, so we're going to start this animation. You know, games like, for instance, Josh, Zombies Revenge. I wouldn't have so much love for that game had I not spent so much time playing that game with my dad and my brother. You know, I just think it's those experiences that it's no different than any other art medium where, you know, music, video games, things like that are pretty much the closest that we're going to ever have to a time machine, dude. Unless I stand corrected in the future, but for now. All right, so he's gonna jump down from here. Ah! Son of a bitch. Which means I get to go hide from him again. Right. Yeah, Monster Party is, yeah, same for a lot of those games, dude. There are, you know, I've really started to watch that My Retro Life show on YouTube, and that dude is super lucky to have that his dad filmed all these crazy moments of them collecting games together and stuff like that. Like, I think it's more about shit like that, dude, you know? And most of those games you do hold in such high regard, even if most other people would look at them like they were shit games. There are a lot of games that I like that aren't highly rated or well received because I grew up playing them. Clock Tower is another one. You don't really hear too many people talk about Clock Tower, but it's a game that I grew up playing, you know, and I probably wouldn't even know about Clock Tower, and it wouldn't mean so much to me. Right. Yeah, those tapes are just still around. And dude, some of the shit that he had, like I saw, I don't know what video it was in, but he cut to, there was like a background, in the background of the video or of the tape that he was showing, there was a Turbo Duo sitting there, and those things are fucking damn near impossible to get your hands on nowadays. And if you don't know what a Turbo Duo is, it is a Turbo Graphics that played the Hue cards, but also had the disc system built into it. The disc system is a lot more pricey to get your hands on. So see, I got the statue now. Yeah, that rare Super Mario Brothers 3 with the typo on the front. I saw that too, dude. Crazy fucking shit, man. You know, I don't think we had any games that were like, that are like considered rare now. But we definitely, my brother Billy and I definitely had games, and my brother Dustin had games growing up that, they wouldn't be considered rare, but definitely worth a lot of money nowadays. Clock Tower itself. Last time I checked to buy a copy of Clock Tower, it was $90, and it was complete. I actually, maybe at the time when I looked at it, maybe it was a sealed copy of Clock Tower. I would buy a sealed copy of Clock Tower if I could find it for the right price. I think that's kind of where I am collecting now. I gotten rid of a lot of my gaming collections, and I just held on to games that mean a lot to me personally. Shenmue on the Dreamcast, still have my copy of that. All right. I don't know if I should just go for getting out of here. Yeah, I think I probably should just try to leave with this statue, honestly. Let me make sure I do have this statue before I bounce, because I don't want to get that ending again. I do have the statue. All right. But yeah, man. I do have a decent Sega Genesis collection, and that's because my dad gave me, like, he held on to the Sega games that we had as kids that we did not get rid of and gave them to me later on down the road of life, and I still have all those, and I've collected a little bit more. Yeah, that's crazy, bro. So now we're going to leave with the statue, which should change the whole course of all this. Yeah, Dino Crisis sealed is crazy. It's crazy that you have a copy of that, bro. I love that game. Another game that probably most people would look at as like a Resident Evil ripoff, but I love the Dino Crisis game. Again, another game that my dad introduced me to. So most of the gaming shit, you know, my mom really wasn't into video games. Weirdly enough, though, Clock Tower is one of the few games that my mom would sit and watch me play. But yeah, my dad was more into gaming, and so he introduced me to a lot of games on PS1, Sega, Dreamcast. Yeah, it was totally a Resident Evil ripoff, but I think there's a little bit more to the game if, you know, you do play the game and kind of not just scratch the surface of it, you know. All right, I don't know where I have to go now. I must meet Nolan soon. The newspaper place? Yes. All right, so this is all going to be new, guys. Like the sound in the background, it's just like random noises with a, you know, a phone ringing every now and then. Just got through being questioned by the inspector. Well, I mean, you did run from a house that a guy had a chandelier fall on him, so. But yeah, it's crazy that you still have a lot of those games, man. I did have a pretty extensive PS1 collection back in the day. However, it was kind of one of those things that when I got older, I think around the time that, you know, PS2 was coming out, I didn't really care for any of the shit on my PS1 anymore, and I should have. Because I could have easily just played most of that shit still on my PS2. But yeah, I didn't hang on to a lot or even buy later on a lot of PS1 games. And that system is, I think the castle is in England. Do you want to go? That system is kind of expensive to collect for now. The Scissor Man was born in England. Yeah, so it looks like we're going to the castle. They're ruining this whole game from a guy with giant blades, but all they have... They all have those noses. They can cut diamonds. Yeah, dude. I didn't even tell you guys. So, I do have Clock Tower 1 on here. I have Clock Tower 2 on here. Or, let's start from the beginning. Clock Tower 1 on Super Nintendo. I have a English translated version of that. And I have a PS1 version of the Super Nintendo version. I guess it was just ported over, but it has CD quality music, so that's a plus. I have this Clock Tower. I have Clock Tower 2, The Struggle Within, which would technically be 3, and I do have a copy of Clock Tower. I actually have a physical copy of Clock Tower 3, but I also have a copy of it on here for PS2, and it runs smooth. And I think it was yesterday or the day before, there was a PC game released that I was kind of unaware of for a long, long time. Called Nightcry, and it gets really, really bad reviews. It's ranked really bad on Steam, but the game is, ever since I've gotten my PC, I keep seeing it always for $25, and I didn't want to buy what would potentially be a shitty game for $25. So it was on, it just so happened to be on sale yesterday or the day before. I got it for $7. So I might get into that sometime down the road, but it is supposed to be part of the Clock Tower series. And again, like I said, it's rated really bad. So I don't know what, there's no time to go home. No one is here. Okay. So where is Helen then? I guess I would go here to tell Helen and Professor Barton that we're, you know, just about to go to England. You guys ever do that with your friends, you know? Be chased by a dude with scissors and like, hey, fuck it, we're going to England now. and just go? Me either. There's no time. Yeah, dude. Yeah, see, I heard you're going to the Barrows Castle. What? So everybody's going to England. Harris, Beth, everybody's going to England. Fuck it, road trip. Yeah, it is insane to me, bro, that you have a sealed copy of Dino Crisis. That's like a fucking holy grail. Even though it's, you know, to most people that wouldn't be a popular game or a game that they would be like, bro, I would love to have a copy of Dino Crisis sealed. I, again, grew up playing that game, so a sealed copy of that shit would be unbelievable to me. And there's not too many games that I would, you know, like, go out of my way to try to find sealed copies for. You know, again, a game that gets kind of poorly rated or talked shit about, but a game that I would love. Yeah, Flashback, dude. Yeah, we talked about that. A game that I would love to find a sealed copy of, and it probably would be ridiculously price-wise just because it's a NES game. But I would love to find a sealed copy of Friday the 13th. I think that would be awesome. I spent a lot of time playing Friday the 13th as a kid because I love the movies. And a lot of people shit on that game, but I loved it. I still will play Friday the 13th from time to time. The old game, not Gun Media's Friday the 13th. We're not going to talk about that. A Secret to Scissor Man. So the Barrows Castle is where we're going, guys. Yeah, the map moves opposite. That is definitely a fucking complaint that I always had, dude. Okay. So they're taking Edward. This is crazy. And it's almost 9. I'm going to take my break at 9 and I got to get another cup of coffee, but yeah, dude, Friday the 13th, when you would switch to that map screen, dude, and you'd ran the wrong direction for the last 5 minutes, that was fucking fun, dude. But I definitely have a lot of nostalgia for that game. I didn't play a lot. I think I did play Nightmare on Elm Street, but I wasn't a big fan of Nightmare on Elm Street at the time, you know, as a kid. So yeah, I would love to find a copy. Yeah. Yeah, definitely get coffee, dude. I would love to find a sealed copy of Friday the 13th on NES. I think that would be dope. There's a shitload of games though, dude, that I plan on playing on here. You know, yesterday I was going through all of the games that I have that I could stream, you know, and beat the games beginning to end. and they would be, you know, my channel related, you know, retro or horror related. And there are so fucking many, dude. Some fun ones on the Dreamcast for sure. Some fun ones on PS1. And I think I have even some, not really modern titles, but like Stubbs the Zombie, I think would be a cool game to stream on here. I remember I beat it like years and years back, but I don't remember a lot of the game. It's been so fucking long ago. But yeah, shit like that, I definitely plan on playing through at some point or another. Clock Tower had to be done. I've played this game just throughout my life pretty much, and I definitely remember being a teenager and my mom seeing me get to this castle that I'm about to be, and I was stuck there for fucking ever and never finished it from there, but I plan on doing that shit. As far as I know, this game is only about roughly an hour and 35 minutes, an hour and 45 minutes, somewhere around in there, depending on how much time you take. But it could be played a bunch of different ways. I'm just looking to get, like, you know, a solid ending. And it might be a game that I return to because I plan on playing the other ones in the series. I've heard not really good things about Clock Tower 2 on PS1, but I've also heard great things about it. So I guess it's just, if you really like the Clock Tower series, this one, you know, going back and playing it, I wouldn't say that it doesn't hold up well still, but I would say that, it's not a game that you're going to involve all this time into, and it's super, super in depth. It's more story driven and, similar to the Clock Tower, I guess it's called the First Fear, would be the one on SNES, or the, PS1 version is also called the First Fear, not this one, but the port. So I just think that it's not a game that, like, is really, really in depth, but if you want to experience a game that kind of paved the way for games like Outlast and stuff like that, where you ran and hid from things, from monsters or enemies, and you weren't able to actually attack them, games like Clock Tower were the ones that, you know, started all that shit. And Outlast is a creepy fucking game. It's definitely creepy. I played it on PS4, I believe, somewhat around launch. It wasn't right at launch, but a little bit after that, I want to say I played Outlast on the PS4, and it definitely reminded me of a modern take on Clock Tower, basically story driven and not point and click. You're literally running and stuff like that, you know, with the analog stick. But you hid from enemies in lockers or under beds and stuff like that, or, you know, behind boxes and shit, and hope to God that the fucking enemies don't find you. So games like Clock Tower just paved the way for shit like that. And it's almost 9. I'm gonna take a 10-minute break. I'll leave you guys with some music, and I will grab another cup of coffee and be back shortly.
changing. This is changing me. It's too late for me now. I am altered. There is something beneath. She's not acid nor alkaline. Caught between black and white. Not quite either day or night. She's perfectly misaligned. I'm caught up in her design and how it connects to mine. I see in a different light the objects of my desire.
We are back. Let's get back into the scissoring. Oh, my controller died. I don't know where we're going. Maybe to, oh yeah, to talk to Nolan probably. I haven't seen Helen or Professor Barton, so. Okay, I don't get it. Why would I go to Rick's house? Okay, where the fuck? Oh, he's back. Yeah, he's back. Professor Barton still believes it's all bullshit. The Barrow's Castle. Yeah. So Barton's going. Everybody's going to fucking England. And obviously, for those who don't know, this is not the first, as I've said, not the first Clock Tower game. So that's why he keeps talking about, you know, the crimes from before and things like that. All right. There's no time. Helen's not here. She's the only person that I haven't run into. Helen might be here. So you have to just hope that these things that you pick end up leading you to where you have to truly go. There we go. These people are just like, this is typical fucking 90s shit right here, dude.